enemy was the enemy. We fought him and we killed him without, you know, any thought. You know, we just were killing Germans, period.
War is a terrible thing. You see the white color in the eyes of your opposite. Yes. And you know exactly when you don't shoot him, he will shoot you.
Hells brew across the Moro River. We saw our own tanks and infantry cross the road in a tempest of fire. And we saw the blasted, twisted olive orchard full of German dead.
It's hard to imagine that this landscape near Ortona was once a killing ground for young men's dreams. It's hard to imagine that Ortona itself, with its picturesque streets, was a town that ceased to exist over Christmas of 1943.
It's nice to be in this lovely country again. This is a gathering of honor.
They came back this Christmas to Ortona, Canadian veterans of the Second World War trying to bury the ghosts of a terrible December. They were coming, a few of them left now, to meet with the Germans they were trying to kill 55 years ago.
My darling,
your grandma.
Flag.
Before any reconciliation with the Germans, the Canadians want to be alone at the cemetery outside Ortona where they left so many of their comrades behind.
Patterson. The Elgins.
John Matheson was a forward artillery officer maimed during the battle. He notes an irony as he walks among the graves of dead Canadians.
Here's the name, here's the fellow who, you know, the first fellow to die in my regiment was a fellow by the name of Schultz. German, pure German. Here's a fellow, Hess, Private Hess, with RCRs, age 25. Now there'd be a boy of pure German background, probably.
Yeah.
Samuel Lenko was a private with the Loyal Edmonton Regiment.
It's tough, I'll tell you. It is really tough. Yeah. I gotta find Don McLean yet, a stretcher bearer. And he went out to help a wounded German soldier where this action took place, and another German shot him, you know. And he had the Red Cross band on his arm and everything. Eh? But it was one of those things, I guess, that happened, yeah.
They were mostly young volunteers in their 20s who'd come ashore in Sicily in August 1943 as part of the 1st Canadian Infantry Division.
For at long last, Canadian troops were to go into action.
Their first victories were fierce but small-scale battles against the retreating enemy. The strategy was to keep German troops from the Russian front or from bolstering defenses against the planned D-Day invasion of France. For some, like the Seaforth Highlanders of Vancouver, it was a time when they could still revel in the adventure and glory of war. Town after town was liberated as the Canadians advanced rapidly up the boot of Italy. It was, their general later said, a nursery tale until Ortona.
By the first week of December, the Canadians had advanced up to the valley of the Moro River. From here, they could see Ortona about 5 kilometers away, and some hoped they'd be there after a day or so of fighting. What the Canadians didn't know was that they were about to run into what the Germans called their Winterstellung, a German winter defense line that Hitler had ordered held at any cost. Canada was about to be sucked into its bloodiest battle of the Italian campaign, legendary in its valor, brutal in its cost. A battle that was to become known as Canada's Stalingrad.
Suddenly, the 25,000 soldiers of the 1st Division were up against some of the best units of the Wehrmacht, the Germans holding ideal defensive positions above the ravines and gullies of the Moro Valley. The inferno had begun.
In a morass of mud, against an enemy fighting harder than he's fought before, the Canadians attack and attack and attack.
John Matheson's war ended that day with 6 pieces of shrapnel in his brain.
Tiny little shrapnel. It would cut the arteries like a massive stroke. But we were young, you see, we were 25 and very fit. I was paralyzed from then on. They told me I'd never be able to have children, which didn't prove to be so.
After a series of bloody assaults, a breakthrough, described by a voice that was to become more and more familiar to Canadians.
But at last, like that day, a great officer took his men over again through a curtain of fire and took the high ground, and we were established across the Moro River.
It took almost 2 weeks before the Canadians were able to attack Ortona itself. Inside the town, battalions of Germany's elite 1st Parachute Regiment were dug in, waiting. 55 years later, they too are back, waiting once more for the Canadians as they walk streets whose memories have scarred their lives. Among the parachute veterans are Billy Fretz, who directed the German artillery around Ortona, Hugo Bauer, whose grim job was to rescue the wounded, and Joseph Klein, a 19-year-old lieutenant in 1943. All agree reconciliation has been too long in coming.
Und ich bin stolz, das heute als Deutscher sagen zu dürfen. Ich bin stolz, dass ihr uns eingeladen habt, auch wenn schwer fällt, dass ich hier sein kann noch.
It is terrible, all these killings, but you can't do anything for that. It is gone. It is history, you know. But now we have to be friends.
Back at the cemetery, some Canadian veterans are uneasy about becoming friends with the men who killed their buddies.
Now this gentleman that won the MM with us, Sergeant Major Blaker.
The Seaforth Highlanders' Bill Wharton says it won't be easy for him reconciling with men he once regarded as arrogant Nazis.
No, with mixed feelings, really. You know, I'm not going to come out and say I'm glad to see him, but I'm not, as an individual, I might see the man and I got no feelings of hate for him. But, you know, and possibly the way they act, you know, I don't think, you know, I think they'd be, as far as I'm concerned, they'll be very gentlemen. But I still had that underground feeling underneath that you wondered about it.
Fernand Trépanier, who saw 26 of his Vandu's platoon killed in action, confesses to mixed feelings too.
You know, when we meet them and we think of our boys, I would say sometime, we may forgive them, but we may not forget. We cannot forget, but we'll forgive.
Yet among the graves, some of Canadians so broken they could never be identified, some incredibly as young as 16, some veterans are ready to salute their old enemies.
And these people are worthy of every honor. You know, it was their misfortune to, but they were gallant people, and they thought their cause was right.
Who the hell's gonna carry hatred around all their life?
Ted Griffiths, head of the Canadian delegation, admits he ran into early resistance to the idea of a meeting with the Germans.
I heard more or less, no, I'm not that keen on sort of meeting with the German. They, on the occasion, some of them used the term kraut, which I hadn't heard for many years. But as I say, a little bit of thought, they came around.
Griffiths was in one of the first Canadian tanks into Ortona, trying to clear the way for the infantry. The Germans had blocked off the side streets to force the Canadians onto Ortona's main street, the Corso Vittorio Emanuele.
The hope was to kill the tanks as they proceeded down.
So it was a trap, you know.
a death trap.
Yes.
Three of the Shermans were blown up as riflemen of the Seaforths and the Loyal Edmontons moved further into Ortona. Almost everywhere in the open, they were in the sights of German machine gunners, or advancing through an explosive tangle of mines and booby traps. It was a battle for every block, every corner of the town. A battle at close quarters, fought with brutality, but with such stamina that both sides wondered at the courage of their enemy.
If it wasn't hell, it was the courtyard of hell. It was a maelstrom of noise and hot splitting steel. The more murderous the battle, the harder both sides fought, from window to window, from door to door, in a carnival of fury. The enemy used every trick and every weapon, including flamethrowers.
We had never before, we'd had many battles, but none before in a built-up urban area. And the tactics, we had to develop tactics as we went along in this battle.
The tactics included mouse-holing, as it was called. Explosives and shells were used to break through walls so that the Canadians could advance through buildings, not open streets. In the single most deadly incident of the battle, the Germans blow up a building packed with Canadians.
I talk not at this event.
Oh, please tell me a little about it. Just a little about it.
Just a little.
Carl Beierlein confesses it was he who set the explosives, but he's reluctant to talk, fearing it will poison the approaching reconciliation.
I say only this, we destroyed today a house. In this house was...
booby-trapped?
Yeah, was soldiers.
Mr. Beierlein, he was in the town, and he was one who blew up a house with some Canadians in it. Yeah. He told you, mm-hmm. Yeah.
24 Canadians in it.
24?
Yeah. Mm. How does he feel about that now?
Yeah, not so happy, you know, because war is a terrible thing. You have to do it, otherwise they do it on you. That is the point.
The one surviving Loyal Edmonton is pulled from the building 3 days later.
Yeah, I think the reaction was, well, you blow up my house, I'm blowing up yours.
Which, says Loyal Edmonton Mel McPhee, is exactly what the Canadians did.
Oh, well, it was a desire for revenge. We've got to get back at them because they can't pull that kind of thing off without consequences.
4 days old, the street fighting is reaching a peak of murderous intensity. By now, the mule trains bringing up ammunition to the Canadians are carrying a grim new burden. Field Marshal Albert Kesselring, the German commander, deplores the bloodletting, but says the paratroopers have to hold on because the Allies have made Ortona as important as Rome. On Christmas morning, Griffiths was in his tank, moving into the Piazza San Francesco.
A lot of shooting going on as you come in?
Yes, there was a fair bit of shooting.
German snipers in the church there are about to mow down several Seaforth Highlanders.
And it wasn't until we moved up here that the machine guns opened up from the church.
Griffiths didn't hesitate. He blew the church, seen here a few days later, into pieces.
The fact it was an old medieval church just didn't enter my mind at the moment. And bear in mind, the business of the day was killing. The fact that it was Christmas just didn't enter my mind at that time. But when you survive a battle and you begin to think back on what transpired, this is when all the ghosts arrive. And it is the ghosts of Ortona and it is the ghosts of that church that keep coming back to haunt you.
At another church, Santa Maria di Constantinopoli, Canadians are brought back in shifts for a hasty Christmas dinner a few blocks from the fighting. Roast pork and Christmas pudding are served, and as part of a desperate search for normality, an organist plays Silent Night amid the inferno raging outside.
For that moment, we were able to live in another world, almost.
Wilf Gildersleeve, who played the organ that day, describes the mood as they sang.
Almost in tears, I think, to sing those words. And then, in an hour's time or so, to go back to their fate, what it might be. And for many of them, some of them, it was the last meal on earth. I'm sure that possibly some of the men on the other side were singing the same tune. And I'm sure their feelings were much the same.
Many of the Germans spent their Christmas Eve huddled in an Ortona railway tunnel. Crowded with wounded and dead, memories of the tunnel that night are draped in trauma.
Und morgens muss man halb drei Uhr Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht singen.
Oh, yes.
Und auch Hindenburgkerze und einem mittler großer Sack Apfelsine. Das war unser Weihnachtsgeschenk für die ganzen Leute, wie wir im Tunnel gelegen sind. Und das müssen sie immer an Weihnachten ein ganzes Leben lang rumschleppen. Wir brauchen sie zu Hause nie nichts fragen. 23 schon 24. Geht nicht. Da bin ich wie tot.
On a cold night in Ortona, the German veterans arrive for their first meeting with the Canadians. The reconciliation of old warriors is about to begin.
How are you? Very pleased to meet you. It's been a long time. Now, well, you must come in and meet the boys.
Yes,
come
yes,
on
oh, yes.
Come on in.
Pleased to meet you.
John Matheson, sir. So nice to meet you.
Yes.
Nice to meet you all.
Thank you.
Finally,
yes,
alive
at long last.
Still alive.
That's right.
Some of the Canadians had calmed their anxieties over the meeting by reminding themselves they were volunteers. The Germans, they felt, had no choice but to be conscripted in Hitler's army.
There's one thing I can say. We volunteered to come here, but you were forced to do it.
In fact, all the parachute veterans here were volunteers too. The topic is dropped.
Very good. Seems good. Seems good.
Alan Johnson.
The first meeting goes well, with the exception of one big gaffe. The Vandoo's Leopold Beauchamp shows Willy Fretz a ring he wears, a wartime trophy he cut off from a dead German's finger.
SS?
No, no.
No? By the
blue. Six. Looks like paratrooper, eh?
Fretz tells Beauchamp it was a paratrooper's ring from one of their own.
You get wounded.
Yeah. I have a mere hand here.
I don't like to hear things like that.
No, but that's all right.
In the days before Christmas, old hostilities begin to dissolve. A sense of camaraderie is taking hold. The Seaforce Bill Warden, who had those reservations about the meeting, swaps addresses with Joseph Klein. Maps are brought out as the battle is fought again in friendship.
First met on the Sandro, then you switch here. He asked the Canadian to switch here to meet you there.
At first, Hugo Bauer, perhaps the most traumatized of the veterans, is isolated by his lack of English. But Sam Lenko, who once used his German to encourage the paratroopers to surrender, uses it now to put Bauer at ease.
Hey, yeah. Thank you.
Canadian Army, no.
Thank you very much.
On Christmas Eve, with Wilf Gildersleeve playing the organ at Santa Maria, as he did 55 years ago, the memories of that other Christmas come flooding back. This time, the old enemies are side by side.
We never said we were enemies. I say we were opponents. And we just had to defend our lives as you had to defend your lives. It was just like in a boxing ring. We lost.
The veterans sit down for a memorial dinner together in the same church hall where Canadians got their small ration of comfort on that other Christmas.
My love for you, when you use my might, I'm warm again. My pack is light.
All right, whiskey.
Good, very good. Oh, it's really been fantastic. This is something I never, ever dreamt of. Never thought would it ever happen, you know. It's some totally unbelievable.
When we went to Sicily.
Before saying goodbye to Ortona and each other, there's one last visit to the battleground.
So, Bill, you had mixed feelings going into this reunion.
No, not now. I did. I told Joseph I had mixed feelings. But I don't know, because when you meet these gentlemen, you realize when you talk to them that they're some of the finest people in the world, because they had an esprit de corps in the paratroopers like the Canadian Army had, because we were a volunteer army.
The tensions have gone now. The reconciliation is almost complete.
The veterans weren't the only ones making a kind of pilgrimage to Ortona this week. The voice of that war correspondent you've been hearing was the voice of my father, Matthew Halton. It was a voice that was instantly recognizable to Canadians on the home front, often heartsick for news of their men on the fighting front. Those wartime broadcasts made my father famous, something he rather enjoyed, but something that also made him rather uncomfortable. He once told me that the only real fame belonged to those soldiers who endured so much.
A real coming together tonight.
No doubt about that. Your father would have known that.
My father was with the Canadians as they stormed across the Moro and battled into Ortona. And he was with them early on December 28th when he returned to a forward command post to make a discovery.
The colonel grinned when I came in. I said, "Don't tell me." And he replied, "Yes, I think we've got Ortona." Not 2 minutes later, the radio buzzed. "Sir, the Jerrys have gone, or else they're all dead." Ortona was ours.
Fifty-five years later, they all agreed it was a Pyrrhic victory. Ortona was a ghostly shell, littered with the bodies not only of Germans and Canadians, but of scores of Italian civilians killed in the crossfire or buried in the rubble. From the Moro to Ortona, the Canadian 1st Division had been cut to pieces. There were almost 700 dead, 1,700 wounded, hundreds of others left catatonic with shell shock. On the German side, there were at least as many casualties, over a town that both sides agreed was of minor strategic value. At home, jubilant headlines greet Canada's first major victory of the war. There's an awestruck note of pride in my father's last broadcast from the dead city.
This is Matthew Halton of the CBC. With the fall of Ortona, the Battle of the Moro River is over. Measured on the scale of the last war, this was not a big battle, but it was one of the biggest ever fought by Canadians. And neither in this war nor the last, nor in any other, has there been anything more bitter and intense.
It was, in the end, as if the old soldiers had come to a redemption of sorts.
I hope someday us old buggers can meet again.
I hope so.
And someday maybe you can come to Edmonton.
I think we would set an example.
To a lot of countries. What we're doing now.
This meeting has sort of been a cleansing of the soul in many ways. It's a shedding of some of the ghosts of Ortona. They have forgiven us, and we have forgiven them, and we've come together in a spirit of friendship.
It's you, Lily.
For The National, I'm David Halton in Ortona.